What is up, everyone? My name is Soren Iverson. I'm a product designer at Cash App, and today I'm going to walk through how I design eye-catching dribble shots. First, we're going to talk about composition, then we'll talk about how to use shadow, move on to color, talk about curation, iteration, and then I'll also show you some templates that I made. First off, let's talk about composition. There are three primary ways that I mock things up in Dribbble. The first one we're looking at is a desktop view of a website design. I like this because Dribbble's image format works really well for showing off the top part of a landing page. Since landing pages are supposed to grab attention, it's a great way to get people to click on what you post and engage with it more. The way I think about this is pretty simple. The gray area on this screen is the total size of the Dribbble thumbnail, and the pink area is the mockup. It takes up about 90% of the width and can extend all the way to the bottom. Just like a real website, there's more information below the fold that you can show in additional images you add to your shot. The second template I often use is great for full website designs. By reducing the width of the page within the mockup, you can show more in your thumbnail. Putting two images side by side within this makes the shot feel more dynamic and it lets you show off more of your work. This is great for longer web pages where you want to show off multiple modules at the same time. You can see here how I lay this out. Each web page is about 45% of the total shot width. This allows you enough room for margin on either side, and you can overlap the images a little bit without them detracting from each other. They also don't need to start at the top or end at the bottom like they do in this mockup. You can adjust it to fit the needs of the website you designed. The third template I use is perfect for both mobile apps and websites. Usually I post two mobile images side by side, but you can do a single image or three. I've found any more than that can start to feel crowded, especially in a feed of a bunch of dribble shots. As you can see, I intentionally stagger the vertical position of the phones to make the image feel more dynamic. You can always keep them horizontally aligned. This lets you actually increase the size a bit, which is helpful when you're showing more detailed mobile designs. Now that we know how to compose our shots, let's move on to shadows. When you apply a shadow on Figma, the default is pretty boring visually. Part of this is because shadows are something that need to be used sparingly and intentionally when creating apps and websites. We won't have time to get into that on this video. What we will look at is how to be more visually expressive with shadows. The goal here is not so much to make something functional as it is to make something visually appealing. If we look at the image on the left, you'll see that the shadow by default is very slight and barely noticeable against this gray background. The image on the right, however, feels much more dramatic. It gives the screen a lot more elevation off the background. This contrast will make your work stand out against a feed of other flat images when you're scrolling through Dribbble. The way I get this shadow effect is actually quite simple. The way I do it is with a plugin called Smooth Shadow. If we go to Plugins, Recents, Smooth Shadow, what you can do here is change the color, layers, alpha, and offset of your shadow. You can also adjust the blur to make it more or less defined. Let's move this back to black, and once we feel like it's good, I'll click Apply. Now that we know how to compose our shot and give it life with shadows, let's move on to color. I've seen people post shots to Dribbble where they use the default gray or whatever the background of their Figma canvas was at the time. No matter how good your work is, a lack of color will make things feel dull and easy to overlook. If you aren't super comfortable with visual design, an easy way to choose a color for your shot background is to find the most vibrant or brand color in the design you are sharing and use a tint of that. In this case, I'm going to pull the blue from the save button and reduce the opacity to about 20%. Another approach I've used is gradients and noise. Gradients make a flat color feel a bit more interesting, and grain gives your background a texture that wouldn't otherwise be there. You can make a gradient by grabbing the primary brand color and adjusting the opacity of both points until you like your result. To add grain to a Figma file, I usually search for an image of grain on Unsplash or Google, reduce the saturation, and put it beneath the gradient layer. Then I take the gradient layer and set the layer mode to something like overlay or soft light. The final approach is pretty simple, but I found it works really well. Most of my best performing dribble shots use this approach. What I do is just grab the brand color like this, and then make a very slight gradient. This approach is really simple, but when you're looking at a wall of images that are really flat and don't have a lot of color, something that's this vibrant is going to stand out. All right, so we're using composition, shadow, and color to make our designs more compelling. One last thing we need to touch on is curation. Here we have an abstracted view of someone's Dribbble feed. The colors are all over the place, a different composition method is used in each post, and there's no consistency at all. I've seen tons of Dribbble profiles that look like this, and it demonstrates to someone viewing your profile that you aren't thinking about the bigger picture when looking at your portfolio. You might see this and think, well, should I just post the same thing every day then? Definitely not. If you do, your feed will look boring. This doesn't matter as much on an individual shot basis when people find your work for the first time, but if they see 50 images that look similar, they won't stick around for very long. My solution to avoid a messier or mundane feed has been to curate in sets of three. Dribbble Pro by default posts your most recent content in rows of three on desktop, and it stacks on mobile. When you break up your work into rows of three, someone who's never seen your work before and is scrolling through will be able to more easily visually digest what they're looking at. Even though we're using a lot of the same mock-up styles, the variance of them in addition to the grouping of colors makes it feel cohesive but differentiated. One last thing I'd like to touch on is the idea of iteration and consistency. It took me a long time before I figured out what works and what doesn't. You can see here a screenshot from my Google Analytics profile associated with my Dribbble account. It took months of consistently posting, analyzing, and iterating to land on the templates and approaches that I shared with you today. If you're just getting started or don't want to recreate everything that I just showed you from scratch, I have some free templates to share with you. I went ahead and took the three templates that I shared with you in this video and made them into a resource that you can download both on the Figma community or on Gumroad. The link is in the description. Thanks so much for watching, and if you haven't already, please like, comment, and subscribe. My name is Soren, and I'll see you in the next video.